My name is Kesh, Govinder. I'm a professor of applied mathematics here at the University of KwaZulu-Natal, and it's a pleasure for me to chair this particular session and to host and welcome Professor C.K. Raju to Durban. He is a not infrequent visitor to South Africa, but ironically, given the history of Indians in South Africa, this is actually the first time he's in Durban, so welcome back. It's nice to see you here. I'm sure you've all read Professor Raju's biography. I'm not going to go into the details of his biography because it's quite clear, but just to mention some highlights, it's interesting to know that he obtained a master's in mathematics and a PhD from the Indian Institute of Statistics, the Indian Statistical Institute, my apologies, in Kolkata, India. He started his career as a formal mathematician. He worked in the very technical field of functional analysis, and hopefully he'll say very little about that today. While he was working in functional analysis, he was interested in the first Indian supercomputer and started porting applications to this platform. And like most people who start in pure mathematics and then start working in computational mathematics, he soon realized the problems one has with pure mathematics when you're really applying it. But unlike the rest of us who accept the problems and still go on with our mathematics, he decided that he'll leave formal math behind and move on to really challenge the paradigms that people were exploring in mathematics. He developed a whole new philosophy of mathematics, and I'm sure there are very, very few people who can talk about exploring their own philosophy of mathematics, which he called zeroism. He compiled evidence for the development of calculus in India and its transmission to Europe. And he communicated these ideas through a variety of different textbooks. Very interestingly, he's also looked at the relationship between science and religion, which is something I'm particularly interested in, and would like to hear a little bit more about that. So in addition to his accomplished mathematical background and his various books, he's received various awards, acknowledging the contribution he's made to mathematics, science, and society. Most recently, in 2010, he was given the TGA medal, the TGA gold medal in Hungary in recognition of his efforts to correct some of the mistakes of Albert Einstein, I believe, okay, which is really quite quite remarkable. I was very fortunate to be part of a panel discussion with him a few days ago, and it was a really, very stimulating conversation, and I'm sure you'll all enjoy listening to him as much as I enjoyed being part of that panel the other day. Professor Raju, over to you.
Thank you very much. So my time starts now. Where is my? It's in my pocket. Right. So thank you very much, and I have to thank Professor Rabi Dhantpat, who has invited me here. I think it's something which is extremely important given what is going on right now. And I would also like to thank the kind of hospitality I have received, and particularly yesterday, Professor Devru played this tune for me. I'm very happy with that. So thank you. Thank you. And let me start with this because there's some confusion about the title. It's about decolonizing math and science education and not about the calculus. The calculus was a talk I gave at MIT in 2015. And that was against the MIT MOOC. And you can watch the video, it's online, just Google C.K. Raju MIT. And this talk will include calculus, but it's broader in scope because this is the burning issue today, decolonizing math and science. So the stock belief is that it cannot be done. And I'm sure that the organizers may have had some trepidation at this because this is the belief math and science are objective, they cannot be decolonized, they're universal. So this is not true. Colonial education was justified by Macaulay on the grounds that the colonized needed it for science, and therefore we have to address it if we want to decolonize. Otherwise, any other kind of decolonization will be superficial. And that is believed to this day, that you need Western education for the sake of science and technology. But the thesis is that math is not universal. What is taught today in universities is formal math, and formal math began in the 20th century with Bertrand Russell and David Hilbert, and others, of course. But the math which prevailed earlier for so many thousands of years, since the days of the Rhine Papyrus, was normal math. And if math is universal, we should select that universal math which prevailed for so many thousands of years and use that. No, that's just the end of the story. So if it is not universal, then there should be at least two types of math, and formal math versus normal math. That's the math of the colonized, the normal math. It is still taught to you in primary school. And that's what you learn in primary school, and that's what most people take away. And since science uses math, once you change math, you will also change science. So teaching formal math is justified by asserting that normal math is inferior. The colonizer just asserted that inferiority. You know, just as he asserted the inferiority of races, asserted, you know, that blacks are inferior, browns are inferior, reds are inferior, yellows are inferior. No need for proof. And no dialogue even today. See, last week I was at UCT, and they said that it has to be decided by the formal math community, and which is solely authorized to decide what math to teach. So you already know it's this community happens to be led by the West, and they must be convinced to accept it without dialogue. I'm very happy I've had a dialogue here, extremely happy, right? So this, if there's a dialogue, then everything can be sorted out. But if there is no dialogue, there is a major problem. All right, so there must be a public dialogue, and decolonization really means that what math to teach must be decided locally, not by reference to the West. It must be decided transparently, and it must be decided publicly. People should be publicly able to explain what they are teaching, why they are teaching, how it benefits the society around them, in whatever way, maybe in advanced at the level of advanced technology, no problem. And we can't trust the West because, the formal math community, the leaders of it may be dishonest, as we were just discussing, Sir Michael Attia, the top mathematician who is the only one to get both Fields Medal and the Abel Prize. He twice tried to grab credit for my theory in my published work, and I just brought it along in case you are unsure it exists. And this was the second time he did it after he was personally informed. And the American Mathematical Society then ruled that no apology or correction was needed, and it was enough to acknowledge that my book existed. It was published 10 years ago, and it refused to publish that Attia had been personally informed and that he had made a mistake and that he did it a second time. So this is the book. I have a physical copy of it just in case you don't believe it exists. It exists. And this is the belated acknowledgement that was published. You're all told you must acknowledge published work. It's part of the ethics of the American Mathematical Society, but the ethics is applied selectively. All right, so decolonization aims to overthrow unreasonable Western authority. And especially, of course, over the local syllabus, because academics still remain colonized. Western academics teaches us to trust the West. To get Western certificates of approval, okay, you have a degree from Harvard, from Cambridge, from wherever, that's very important, and that you publish in such and such journals, which are high impact journals, which are all controlled by the West. So they are constantly driven to seek Western approval. This becomes very problematic in, for example, the Islamic countries, but it is done. So this is the decolonization thesis. Formal math must fall. Okay. So, because I hope I'm sticking to the local idiom. So what is this normal math versus formal math? What is the difference, right? And basic difference, critical difference is that normal math accepts the empirical in proof in various things, in definitions, whereas formal math prohibits it. And in normal math, say 1 plus 1 equal to 2 is because, let's say, one bottle and one bottle make two bottles, so one chair and one chair makes two chairs, and that's what you learned as kids, and if somebody is asked, this is how they will try to prove it, typically, not a formal mathematician, but any ordinary person. But in formal math, Russell, well, Whitehead and Russell to be precise, needed 378 pages to prove 1 plus 1 equal to 2. 378 pages, and this is the 378th page. Can you understand one character in it? Complete gobbledygook. All right, and this is 378 pages of this stuff to prove 1 plus 1 equal to 2. Okay, and since science and engineering are about the real world, see, there's always this fear if you change, superstitious fear of change. If you change, something terrible will happen. Why? Because science and engineering accept empirical proofs. If you accept them in mathematics, nothing terrible will happen. They'll continue to work for science and engineering, certainly. So it involves no loss. On the other hand, it will involve some gain. Because normal math is easy, so students are able to do much harder problems. Much harder problems which are not currently taught. For example, non-elementary elliptic integrals, they are not taught as part of a normal calculus course, university calculus course, but they are taught as part of my decolonized course. So you can do that because it's no more difficult to work with SNC and DN than it is to work with sine cosine. I will try to show that if I have time. So if the purpose of teaching math, we have to decide why we are teaching math. The purpose of teaching math is for its practical applications to science and engineering. Let's do it this way. There's absolutely no harm, no loss. But that's not the sole purpose of teaching it, because formal math begins with axioms. But those axioms are all laid down in the West. Are you teaching anything, any aspect of the syllabus which involves an axiom developed by an African? I don't think so, right? So what they teach you is you must believe those axioms and the consequences from it. The reasoning for everything goes back to those axioms. So if formal math falls, then Western authority falls with it. It's the last bastion, so to say. And I think that's terrible, of course, but that's exactly what decolonization is about. It's terrible, it's unpleasant, but what happened earlier was also unpleasant. We need to decolonize. So it's overthrow of colonial authority. That's what it's about. We can't accept the authority. Reasoning, yes, we'll accept all reasoning, right? Anything reasonable you're willing to accept. If something is bad, we throw it away. If something is good, we accept it, right? So academics, in a sense, the last frontier of colonialism. So the second difference is that normal math is easy. 1 plus 1 equal to 2, you all understand. Those 378 pages, I don't think anybody understands. I'm probably never seen them, right? It's extremely difficult to understand for anybody, even an expert mathematician. Nobody reads that kind of stuff, but you trust it. And that's the problem, right? If anybody does understand, if I made a mistake, please raise your hand. 378 pages? No. All right, let me go ahead. So today, you don't do it that way. You do it using set theory, not Peano's axiom, set theory, but formal set theory is equally complicated. And defining a set becomes a very problematic thing because it's a very complex metaphysics of infinity. I did that at some stage, but then I abandoned it. So you just trust the mathematics committee. Most mathematicians do naive set theory. They trust it, despite issues such as the Banach-Tarski paradox. What's the Banach-Tarski paradox? You can take a ball of gold, you can divide it into a finite number of pieces, which you can reassemble into two balls of gold of equal size. Easy way to become millionaires. All right? That's what you can do with axiomatic set theory. So formal math makes the simplest things too complicated. You have to trust the West at some stage, and therefore you become perpetually dependent on the West. You have to seek their approval, you have to seek the postulates, and so on. Let me give another example. 1 plus 1 equal to 2, too hard. So I understand you're not mathematicians. Let's take a simpler problem, easier example, a point. And this is something which is taught in class 6 in Indian school texts. And what they teach is this, that geometric points are invisible. Now, invisible, now how do you work with geometric points? You know, it looks like a contrick. And I asked this question in UCT, how many people work with invisible points? Will somebody here tell me? Anybody raise their hands? Well, you did work with it. They're also a formal mathematician, raised the hand. But I think there is a problem. You see, like the emperor's invisible clothes, this may involve a contrick that the mathematician is able to magically see it in his mind's eye that there is something which exists, you know, conflated with Platonic math or whatever, that there is this real number and so on. It's very problematic because you do not actually work with it. What you actually do is you work with dots. So it could be a contrick that only intelligent people understand those invisible points, but it might be like this. No? You will know the story about how the king was fooled. Only intelligent people can see the invisible things. So they don't exist on common sense, and this is part of my thesis, that though through formal math, students are taught to reject common sense, don't accept common sense, and to accept the authority of the school text. It's a way of teaching that. Very critical aspect. Because this authority of the school text, we are not able to change it so easily. Students can't change it, teachers can't change it, it comes from the West, right? If we had to change the syllabus, and if they changed it in Harvard and Cambridge, we would accept it overnight. There would be no dispute at all. The dispute arises because it's not coming from the West. So that was an essential aspect of colonial education, was an essential aspect of colonialism. That's just what I want to do very quickly. And why is that? Because colonial higher education came as church education. All early universities Western universities, Cambridge, Oxford, Paris, Bologna, etc. They were all set up by the church, they were all controlled by it until at least the 20th century. The first bill for secular education in Britain was 1871, that was only for primary schools, didn't touch the universities. So they were 100% controlled by the church until the 20th century. So colonial education was designed. Why was it designed? Why did the church set up universities? Why did it do that during the Crusades? Because they were designed to indoctrinate their products. They were designed to create missionaries who would fight about all sorts of absurd things in the teeth of opposition. Right? And who fanatically trust authority against common sense, for example, virgin birth, which is the basis of church ethics, would believe it and fight about it. So Macaulay told the colonized that they needed Western education for science, but what did he tell the British Parliament in 1947? He said that education was the cheapest way to control revolt, to contain revolt. He said that it's the state's duty to provide free education to everybody so as to indoctrinate them. And the first universities were set up in India immediately after the revolt of 1857, as per Macaulay's plan. Strange that the church, which is supposedly against science, brought science to the heathen. Why? Did it want to commit harakiri by introducing one enemy to another? So the best science colleges in India are still those set up by the church. So I will leave you to reflect on it, and maybe I'll come back to it later. So it's a myth that colonialism was established by guns. All right, in India, the colonizer was militarily weak and could not match the military might of the Mughal Empire or even the Vijayanagar Empire. And they had bad technology, they didn't have that kind of steel and so on and so forth. It's very inferior technology. And their first military victory came after 250 years, that's a very, very long time compared to our lifespan. And that was in 1757. Of course, they used an advanced technology. Very advanced technology with which people are not familiar. It was the technology of bribery and deceit which went to an extreme extent. So they bribed the opposite army with false promises. That's what happened in the skirmish of Plassey. But at that stage, the West was still technologically challenged. It did not know how to navigate. Very basic issue, how do you bring people from there? And the proof of that is that the British Longitude Prize was given away only in 1762. And though it was given away, only half the prize was given because they were not sure whether it had been won. It's a fact, you know, they couldn't decide what was the longitude. So for a free people, we need to fundamentally redesign education so that it frees the mind and does not enslave it, does not indoctrinate it. So that's what I'm suggesting. It's not merely tinkering. We need to fundamentally redesign things, and we'll have to look at everything. Now, the next point I would like to make is that there are certain myths and superstitions which come along with formal math. So because it originates with the church, it has this. It's accompanied by myths and superstitions. So what are the two key myths? The two key myths, the first one is about Euclid, that there was a Euclid who was the father of geometry, was a white father of geometry. You'll find his picture. Just Google, you'll get millions of hits. And that he gave deductive proofs. That's the second myth. Both are complete falsehoods. But they are taught in our math texts. They are taught in India in the 9th standard math text that Euclid and the Greeks did something in a very special way, and we must imitate it because they did something special. So if you ask them what's the evidence for Euclid, oh, we don't need evidence, we go by a committee. That's the answer I got from the NCERT, which is our national body. But of course, I think things are changing now. So there is no evidence for Euclid or, of course, his white skin. If he didn't exist, how can you argue about the color of his skin? And there is not a single pure deductive proof in the book Elements. You can examine it and find out. And this is known for at least 100 years. We're still talking about it. There isn't a single pure deductive proof starting from the first proposition to the last. Everything makes use of the empirical. And that was not the intention to give pure deductive proofs. So the book was written by another person at another time for another religious purpose, which I won't be getting into too much. You should read the book. So that's the black woman who was the mother of mathematics, if you were to call Euclid the father of mathematics. And when I argued this out, some people in the conversation last year, it was censored my article, and some people got furious. What is this? How do you say Euclid was a black woman? But no one claimed my prize. I offered a prize of 40,000 ZAR, 40,000 Rand for evidence about Euclid, and this prize has been standing for 7 years. Why doesn't somebody claim it? Because there will be a public discussion and the whole thing will be exposed. So nobody wants to do that, and they just want to keep saying behind the back, oh, this is not wrong, this is wrong, let's suppress it, but come out in the open and discuss it. Let everybody know all the nonsense that has been done. And the experts, the leading experts, Western experts, know that there is no evidence for Euclid. This was admitted almost 17 years ago by David Fowler. Somebody said, who is this C.K. Raju? What is he asking about? What is he saying? Why is he questioning? What do we know about Euclid? So he gave a one-word answer. What do we know? Nothing. All right. What do we know about the book? Well, the book is closer in time to us than it is to the purported date of Euclid. That was his answer. It is still there on the Historia Mathematica site, about 2001, I think, or 2000. So that's my next contention, that Euclid must fall, this kind of false history must fall. All right? We must get it down, because if, so long as it stays in the text, people get worried, they believe their school text, and so on. So the myths are accompanied by superstitions, and this one superstition is that deductive proofs are infallible. So that's not true. Deductive proofs are obviously fallible. Why? One simple reason is that an invalid proof may be accepted as a valid proof. That is exactly what happened in the case of the elements. That it had invalid deductive proofs and they were accepted as valid for centuries, 7th century, 1125 it came, and around 2000 it was, around 1900 it was accepted that they are, wrong. That's what Bertrand Russell said. But of course that was not never the intention to give deductive proofs. So 1125 to 1900, all Western scholars, because it was compulsory study in Cambridge, which we imitated. So during the, basically it relates to the church theology of reason, which was adopted by the church during the Crusades because there was a corresponding Islamic Akli Kalam and so on. And Euclid, the elements was used to teach reasoning to priests. We still follow that Cambridge syllabus. But this reasoning involved a trick. What was the trick? It started from anti-empirical metaphysical premises, which cannot be verified. So it can be used to prove any, reach any predetermined conclusion. Anything can be deductively proved starting from appropriate postulates. What are the postulates then has to be approved authoritatively. That's the problem. So the Lokayat in India, that's a school, everybody accepted empirically manifest and the inference from that, but the Lokayat rejected inference. And their stock example was that of a wolf's footprint. This was a long time back. Man went to a village and he made footprints all the way from the gate to the central square. In the morning, people came and said a wolf was around. And he had wanted to persuade his girlfriend, so he told her, see, you saw me making the footprints, and these fools, they do not understand. And they infer the existence of a wolf from the footprints, which could have been made by a person. They didn't think of it. So that's what happens if your postulates are not empirically verified. But how do you verify them? You cannot verify the premises of formal math. You can never verify them, because everything involves, whether geometric points or 1 plus 1 equal to 2, it involves an anti-empirical metaphysics, which I've explained it as fantasy of infinity. So this metaphysics, you're asking about that, maybe I'll go into it for 2 minutes, is closely related to church dogmas of eternity. So I have a chapter on curse on cyclic time, the 11 pictures of time, and there's also an article on eternity and infinity. It's published in some American philosophical journal. That's the book. And I'm giving you an example of how it works. This is a book on physics of immortality by Tipler, who's a professor of mathematical physics in the US. And this bad metaphysics of infinity, particularly from calculus, creeps into science. Through this, church dogmas creep into science. And what he is talking about in the physics of immortality is this. You can see these things. When will the dead be raised? Why will the dead be raised? That's the kind of stuff he's talking about. Professor of mathematical physics, and he claims this is theology is a branch of physics. Physicists can infer by calculation the existence of God and the likelihood of resurrection of the dead to eternal life exactly as they calculate properties of the electron. And he says the central claims of Judeo-Christian theology are in fact true, and these claims are straightforward deductions of the laws of physics as we now understand them, and I have been forced into these conclusions by the work of Stephen Hawking and Roger Penrose. Right? Global general relativity. So Tipler only explains the irrefutable theology of Stephen Hawking, singularity theory, and that involves this business of calculus, that your differentiable function must be continuous. So if you have a discontinuity and you try to differentiate, you'll get an infinity, and then infinity you can reinterpret whichever way you want. So this is an article which I wrote. It's just explaining this stuff, making it explicit, so am I. So is anyone here willing to laugh at the authority of Nature, which published 650 plus papers, and Stephen Hawking? All silent. Laugh. Think of that girl who said, okay, she didn't know any science, she didn't know anything, she said lightning, go back, and you're still laughing. Millions of people, and you dare not laugh at the Western authority even though he's talking such nonsense. It's obvious nonsense. But it is published at the highest level, it's published through the highest authority, and so on. So last point about formal math is that it uses two-valued logic for proofs. And that's a naive theological assumption that logic binds God. So said by Al-Ghazali, I won't go into the whole debate. But from even before the real Aristotle, it's not the real Aristotle when you talk of Aristotle and logic. Buddhists and Jains used a different logic, and which is similar to quantum logic, which empirically prevails at the microphysical level. So two-valued logic at best is approximate, empirically, and it's not culturally universal. So a formal mathematical theorem is not a necessary consequence of the postulates. Depends on both things, depends on postulates, depends on logic. And for example, in calculus, the existence of a Lebesgue non-measurable set, you prove by contradiction, that proof would fail if you had a quasi-functional logic. So this is the summary. No Euclid, no deductive proofs in Euclid in the elements. Deductive proofs are fallible. And anti-empirical deductive proofs or postulates can be used to prove anything that one wants, anything predetermined by authority. And all postulates underlying formal mathematics are metaphysical, cannot be empirically verified. And two-valued logic is neither culturally universal nor empirically certain. So I think that completely finishes off, and that's why I have this thesis of formal math must fall. Okay, so common doubt is, doesn't formal math work? Doesn't. You believe formal math works? Only if you don't know formal math, right? It does not work for practical applications. For example, calculus, the way you teach it, and I'm sure you teach it using formal real numbers, you have limits and so on. But you cannot write down a single formal real number like square root of 2, exactly. You can only write it down approximately. And if you write it down approximately, it's not a formal real number, an infinity of real numbers close to it. So formal real numbers are not real, you can't get them, you can't catch them any more than you can catch invisible points. So they can never be used for practical applications. A computer, real computer, not Turing machine, can hence never use formal real numbers, it uses floating point numbers. And they obey completely different arithmetic, no associative law, and so on. So that's normal math, anything you can do with computers, and most practical applications are today done using computers, so nothing will happen to practical applications, absolutely nothing. Don't be scared, don't have the superstitious fear. So what's the alternative? Okay, so the alternative math was worked out by a multiversity group, well, mostly me, Malaysia, Iran, India, tried out there over the last decade. Tested with experiments with 8 groups in 5 universities across 3 countries. And being taught right now in school and university to school and university students in India today. Well, it was a few days ago, and still will be taught a few days later. By today, I mean extended present. So the easiest way to understand the alternative is through history. That Euclid, etc., are not the sole falsehoods of the West. It includes Copernicus, Newton, and many others. So I have a lot of them hanging upside down in my book, Science, Western, and Origin, which you can download. So by the way, I'm not proposing to reject everything Western. Only a critical rejection, whatever is useful, you retain. As publicly explained in my debate in Malaysia long ago, there was, because the editor of The Sun wrote an article on my talk, they all fell like 9 pins, like Saddam Hussein's statue fell, and this created a whole uproar in the country. Everybody was writing against me and saying all sorts of things. Oh, you want to reject everything Western, so that's what I said. You've never seen what we have done, you never come to the conference, never heard what we are proposing, so we are proposing that you be critical and choose what is best, but do criticize the West, and the criticism is not something which has to be authorized or sanctioned or accepted by them. If we find it valuable, we'll accept it. So the other part is to be able to learn from the past. You must replace, you must have the truth. If you don't have the truth, if you have some myth which glorifies, you're not going to learn anything from the past. So you want to look at the real history of math and science. And, well, the Greeks were arithmetically challenged. They contributed nothing to math. And there is no evidence that they did anything with the Archimedes and so on. They didn't know how to do their calendar. Their calendar is so hopeless. It's a very good proof. It's a very good proof that they were arithmetically challenged. They didn't even understand fractions. Now, most math, arithmetic, algebra, geometry, trigonometry, calculus, probability. This originated as normal math in the non-West. It was imported by the West for its practical value. For example, arithmetic for commerce. Well, first Pope Sylvester, Gerbert imported it in the 10th century, but then the Florentine merchants got it because they realized its value for commerce. Trigonometry for calculus, trigonometry and calculus for navigation. That was the critical scientific challenge in the West from the time of Vasco da Gama to 1762. Probability for games of chance, what you have Pascal and Fermat and so on, they had access to these Indian sources. The point is, not only was it stolen, it was not properly understood. It's just like, you know, you have a student who copies from the neighbor, he copies everything, gets it all right, but doesn't fully understand it. He may understand part of it. It took centuries for people to understand things. And the very names tell this story that, you know, you have zero from Zifra or Sifra, which is cipher, which means mysterious code. And I have explained this in that MIT talk in great detail. Greek and Roman numerals are additive. But zero involves place value. So they didn't understand their place value system. And they said, what is this mysterious entity which has no value in itself and adds on any amount of value? You know, like XII in Roman numerals is 10 plus 1 plus 1. But 102 is not 1 plus 0 plus 2. And so you can add on any number of zeros at the end of a financial contract. And so Florence banned them, passed a law in the 13th century saying that if you do it in these strange Arabic numerals, you must also do it in words. That's what we still follow, all financial contracts. So the word sign derives from Latin sinus. This is part of the Toledo translations, which means fold or jeb. Comes from the Arabic jeb, according to OED, which is correct. Now even Amartya Sen accepts it. So it's a misreading of jiba. He doesn't point out this part, which is from the Sanskrit ja, or chord. So the sign relates to the circle. It's there in all chapters on the circle in all Indian texts. So trigonometry, as you call it today and teach it, involves a conceptual error. It should be circlemetry. But you have no means to teach circlemetry because you teach geometry with a compass box, which has no instrument to measure a curved line. Only instruments to measure a straight line. Right? So that's a problem. There was no Claudius Ptolemy. Of course, Egyptians and Iraqis, Babylonians knew about it. And trigonometry was transmitted in multiple phases. Final phase was direct from India in the 16th century for the specifically European navigational problem. Others knew how to navigate from long before, but Europeans didn't. So they needed these precise values, and they needed it to determine latitude, longitude, loxodromes. I can't discuss it in too much detail because, as you can see, this 500-page book. If you'd like, you can read it. I can't cover it that fast. So I'll just give you something. Jesuits stole this from Cochin, where they were running a college teaching Malayalam to the locals in 1550, and mass translating local texts to Latin the way they did in Toledo. And these precise trigonometric values were stated by Madhav in the 14th century. And this is the statement. It's a poem, all right? It's a poem, not even in Sanskrit, but it's in Devanagari script. And these are all set of numbers, Shrestham Nam, Varishtanam, and so on. And these are the numbers. They are in reverse sexagesimal katapayadi system. That's minutes, seconds, thirds. Kala vikala tatpara. So if you're looking at this, well, I'm sure you don't understand it. So let me give it to you in terms of decimals so you can see the level of accuracy. So third sexagesimal minute, that's how accurate they are. And so these values were needed, and therefore they were taken. And then Clavius, the chief Jesuit, published them in his name in 1608. But this process started long ago. Started with Aryabhatta in the 5th century. So he stated it like this. This is another numerical notation, another thing. Can't explain it. It is explained in my book. I'll just give you the values. So he's talking about kala the ja. He's using the word ja here. And these are the values. Kala is minutes. Those are the only two Sanskrit words there. Everything else is number. And the circumference of the circle in minutes is assumed to be 21,600 because it's 360 degrees into 60. So his innovation, chief innovation, was the use of numerical techniques instead of geometric techniques to calculate, you know, it's not opposite side by hypotenuse. And that is today called the Euler method. Of course, Euler had access to Indian sources, and he wrote an article on the Indian calendar in 1700. So they were used to calculate accurate values. It's because it's not something you can do geometrically. Geometrically, you can only work where there is symmetry. But if you are looking at 24 sine values, there is no symmetry. It works in simple cases, but doesn't work in that case. So he was criticized for using linear interpolation, then Brahmagupta used quadratic interpolation, what is today called Stirling's formula. And that was also used by Bhatteshwar in the 9th century to calculate 96 sine values accurate to the seconds until you came to this thirds. He used 11th, 12th order interpolation to achieve this accuracy, but this actually involved infinite series. Now, I can give you the infinite series if I have time, but right now I'm not sure. So these were the Taylor series, so-called, for sine, cosine, and arctangent. And the Leibniz series, so-called, for pi. And they are discussed, all of them are discussed in my book in the third chapter. The point is that infinite series were summed. But, for example, the first formula that you find, first written formula for the sum of an infinite geometric series was given by Neil Kant in his commentary on Aryabhatta, Ganit 22. So that's the formula. Again, I'm not sure it makes sense to anybody. But basically, it's a similar formula to what you study for the infinite geometric series. And but the difference I'm trying to point to is that today, infinite sums are done using limits. And so people say, oh, there were no limits, there were infinite series. But these limits are a particular metaphysics of infinity. You can do it differently. And in India, there were some differently using what is called non-Archimedean arithmetic. Let me just pause for a minute to explain. Now, in the Western notion of limit, you are assuming that you go to infinity, everything becomes perfect. In the non-Archimedean arithmetic, when you use, you assume that even at infinity, the same problems persist. Except that the differences become minute. Instead of being finite, they become infinitesimal. So you have infinities and infinitesimals in non-Archimedean arithmetic. And there was a philosophy of discarding infinitesimals or small numbers right from the time of the first text that you have got, like the Shulva Sutra. So they call square root of 2 as savishesh. You cannot get an exact value. Always will have a remainder. So this discarding of infinitesimals used philosophy of inexactitude called zeroism. I'm sorry, there's an error there called zeroism. Delete the off. Or Shunyavad. And Shunyavad rejects the fantasy of exactitude at infinity as an error. And if you don't understand it, what can I do? You don't teach philosophy. It is bad education that you have here. You should learn about other systems. If you don't learn anything about other systems, now I have to start by giving a lecture on Plato. I cannot explain what Plato said, right? It takes too long. All right, the word algebra comes from Algebra wal Muqabla of Al-Khwarizmi of Baghdad, who took the work of Brahmagupta and translated it, or transcreated it. And Brahmagupta called polynomials, such as 2x plus 3, as unexpressed numbers. You see, it acquires a value only when you give a value to x. And then he, naturally, if you are working with numbers, you'll work with fractions. So 2x plus 3 upon 3x plus 4, for example, is a fraction. Or a rational function, as it is called today. And such rational functions today constitute what is today called a non-Archimedean ordered field. So that derivation is given there in many of my lectures, including the lectures I gave in Calculus Without Limits recently. So once again, I repeat, we are not advocating non-Archimedean arithmetic because it is Indian in origin, but because it is better. There's a difference between indigenization and decolonization. So I am arguing for decolonization, not for mere indigenization. Use the indigenous where it is better. And it is better in many cases, so don't have to panic about it. So the non-Archimedean arithmetic leads to better calculus today. So let me explain, since there is a mathematician, let me quickly explain that university calculus fails for discontinuous functions, right, which cannot be differentiated. So a differentiable function must be continuous. But shocks and discontinuities arise in physics. And those shocks and discontinuities means one has to make sense of the partial differential equations of physics in the presence of a discontinuity. How do you do that? So you can replace it by Schwarz distributions, but or generalized functions, but it doesn't work because Schwarz theory is a linear theory. That also fails for shocks because they are nonlinear differential equations, so you have to multiply distributions, and Schwarz proved an impossibility theorem that it is impossible to do so. The solution which I proposed long ago was to use non-standard analysis, an extremely complicated thing. But you don't require, the only aspect of it which you require is the non-Archimedean arithmetic which comes in and the philosophy of discarding infinitesimals. So that's what I'm using here. That's the idea. That it does, you do better at a higher level as well. It's not merely confined to something elementary. All right. So to summarize, decolonized calculus involves three major changes. Teach calculus as the numerical solution of differential equations, some infinite series using non-Archimedean arithmetic, then no limits, calculus without limits, teach zeroism, or a philosophy of inexactitude. All right. So the advantages, as I said, are that it makes calculus very easy, extremely easy. There's conceptual clarity. Students don't understand what they are taught normally, and they become clearer. There's the ability to solve harder problems, such as elliptic integrals. There it leads to better science, and of course, better science teaching, distinguishing between the two. So let me give you some of the results. The experiments are performed with one group in Central University of Tibetan Studies, four groups in USM, Penang, and social science students in Ambedkar University, Delhi, in CISSC, Tehran. And it's running currently as a regular course in HGT University, Delhi, with 72 students. So conceptual confusion about calculus among most students, they flunk the pretest. All right, even the postgraduate students flunk the pretest, and half of them dropped out. So this is a pretest. And see, I'm not asking them something very difficult. Are you able to read it? I'm just asking them, can you define a point? Can you define a number? Can you define a set? Can you define the sine function? Can you explain what is the what is sine of 92 degrees? Can you calculate sine of 0.1 degrees? What is the limit? Can you define? What is a derivative? What is an, and they don't, they define derivative in terms of tangent. So I give them this graph that they don't know what a tangent is. All right? And goes on like that. What is an integral? They think of integral as area. And finally, there you have the elliptic integral, which they don't know how to solve, because they learn only the formulae for elementary functions. Right? And then I look at applications. If you're looking at real science, at what angle should you throw a cricket ball? It's not 45 degrees. All right. So if you're looking at a simple pendulum, is the formula of t equal to 2 pi root over l by g correct? It's not correct. So this is the kind of thing that happens. Everybody flunked and they got negative marks, unfortunately, because of the policy that I stated. So this is what happens. This is for the postgraduate people. That test is a little harder. Basically, the main new feature is that they learn, for example, three types of integrals. Right? They learn the antiderivative, they learn the Riemann integral, they learn the Lebesgue integral. So I asked them to explain what's the connection between these. And then there are some simple problems and so on. Well, problems of probability theory, because they need measure theory in order to understand, do they understand it, and so on. Okay. So in contrast, once they do the calculus without limits course, they could manage much harder problems. So this is an example of the tutorial. Just take a look if any one of you is an expert and can manage to differentiate these ugly looking things. So they can do it in a jiffy, no problem. X squared e raised to root x, no problem. What is this tan inverse, cos hyperbolic inverse, and so on. And these kinds of integrals, and there is finally an elliptic integral there. They can solve differential equations like the van der Pol equation and so on. So this is what they are able to do after the course on calculus without limits. And these are some of the things for the postgraduate students. The post-test, as you can see, they performed very well. They all flunked. Half the class dropped out after the pre-test, right? And this is how they were able to do at the end of the post-test. This is how the applied math students did. Most of them did very well. And this is how the pure math students did. And this is how the non-math students did. So they all did extremely well in the post-test. All right, so these are some of the, just in case you're not sure they exist, this is the thing at Central University of Tibetan Studies. This is the group at Tehran. This is the group at Ambedkar University, Delhi. And this is the group currently going on. It's not the entire group, there are actually 72 people, but this is all that can fit into one lab. They just took the photo in one lab. We neglected to take a group photo, but there is a video. You can take a look at that. So I'll skip over this business of decolonizing science, but the point is that changing the understanding and teaching of calculus means science must change. You don't have tricks like Hawking and Tipler. You don't have church dogmas like laws of nature in science. That was a dogma stated by Aquinas. So you don't have Newton's laws of motion or universal law of gravitation. It also means that history and philosophy of science must change. That leaves the West with a lot of egg on the face. Can't glorify Newton and Leibniz. They did not invent calculus. They did not even understand it. Hence, Newtonian physics failed. I won't go into that. There is not enough time, maybe on the questions or outside. So correcting Western misunderstanding does lead to a corrected version of Newtonian gravitation. You do have alternative science, not just in short waves, in gravitation, and in terms of quantum mechanics and so on. I'm not going into that because it's too complicated to explain. Gravitation, very easy example, retarded gravitation theory. So better skills at calculus also lead to better science teaching. Simple pendulum, for example, or the example I gave, a ball that you throw or javelin that you throw, and you want to be able to deal with elliptic integrals. In fact, that's why I developed my software CalcCode to teach my children this kind of science when they had a problem. So there are other decolonized courses. And on history, philosophy of science, which was taught several times at Al-Bukhari International University, and Egyptian-Indian cot geometry, being tried out currently with school children in India. And so I'll just show you the pictures since there is only 2 minutes left, and maybe I'll show you one of the things. So this is the history, philosophy of science group at Al-Bukhari University, and I took them to measure the size of the Earth. Such a simple thing to do if you know trigonometry. Clavius couldn't do it. Size of the Earth was measured by Picard in 1670 and Clavius published in 1608. So you're measuring the Earth, such a simple thing. This is the group, it became so popular, they asked for a second round course, and that's the second group, and they persisted even when the university closed. It closed because we were doing decolonized stuff. They got very concerned and very worried. So similar backward integration with Egyptian-African cot geometry, Indian cot geometry, not because it's indigenous, but because it is better. Okay, so current teaching conflates several types of geometries, Hilbert synthetic geometry and formal geometry, Hilbert synthetic and formal geometry with empirical and metric compass box geometry. You teach both the things. Ruler should be unmarked and you can measure with a ruler. And the students are naturally confused, right? So the compass box is inferior, as I said, it has no instrument with which to measure a curved line. So teaching cot geometry leads to conceptual clarity about point, angle, arc, etc. And teachers accepted this during a workshop. This is the home assignment that was given for teachers during the workshop. So you can just quickly take a look of it. Look at it. Is the length of a line segment defined on Hilbert synthetic geometry? They don't even mention that there are several types of geometry. So the idea is that this workshop teaches them that there are these five types of geometry which are being mixed together: Hilbert synthetic geometry, Birkhoff metric geometry, Euclidean geometry, so-called compass box geometry. They're all different. And the geometry of the Shulba Sutra, or the geometry of the cot, right? So this is what is done there. And now it's very brief, I'm sorry. But I have a lot of material, as I said, I can't cover all of it. And so this, again, just to assure you that the group exists, is being tried out with 40 schools here in Nasik, that's in Maharashtra. I'm just finishing in 30 seconds. And this is the group in Chamrajnagar, and the teachers were very happy. They asked for a repeat workshop. So this is the group in, again, in Karnataka. And this is the textbook which has been written for it. There's a textbook in existence, so you can take a look. And the conclusion I would like to say is that there is ample material for decolonized courses available. You're just talking, no action. But you have that. Of course, it's your choice whether whether academics remain subordinate to the West and create indoctrinated minds, or, and you have time until the next time the students revolt and burn down the university. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Raju, for what was clearly a tour de force on decolonization, the mathematics and science curriculum. There was a huge amount in that 45 minutes, and I hope everybody took at least something out of there. I think it was a really quite interesting talk. We are running out of time, but I will just take a few questions. I'm sure there will be some questions from the audience. Yes.
Maybe to start off by saying that I don't understand mathematics. I don't know mathematics or even the history of mathematics
like
or science to know whether you're talking sense or nonsense. But I want to applaud you on the courage and the fact that you had no sacred cows. You questioned the biggest thinkers, and that to me is something to be applauded. I want to ask if you could elaborate a little bit on the concept of zeroism as nothingness, but inexactitude, in the context of how we could use it as a metaphoric tool to further unpack colonialism and the colonized mind. And the second question that I inherited was for you to further elaborate on IKS and decolonialism. Thank you.
On what?
IKS, Indigenous Knowledge System, and decolonialism.
Right. So zeroism is something which comes from Shunyavad. So Shunyavad is a theory of inexactitude. It says that idealism is erroneous. It's a Buddhist thought which was supposedly first formulated by Nagarjun. I call it zeroism, not to claim originality, but only to say that should not be confusion with the text. Because Nagarjun's texts are very difficult to read and understand, and first time I talked about it, I entered into a one-hour argument with a professor of philosophy on what is the exact interpretation of Nagarjun's work. So zeroism means inexactitude, like you have come and you have changed, you have listened to things and your body has changed, the molecules have changed, so empirically you have changed in the last 1 hour, and mentally you have changed, but that change does not matter. I zero it because it's irrelevant to the context. When I talk about two dogs, those two dogs are never identical. But I ignore the difference until one of the dogs comes to bite me, and then I have to wonder whether it's a big dog or a small dog, which I can kick away, right? So that's the issue. You can make the distinction when you want. When you don't want, you can zero the difference. That's the basic thing about Shunyavad, that we are constantly changing. It's not due to Heraclitus. You're constantly, you don't talk of change because then there has to be something against which you measure the change. So every instant, you are a new person. Likewise, so you have to deal with inexactitude all the time in everyday life. There's a lot more to it. I have an article on zeroism in the Springer Encyclopedia. Maybe you could take a look at it. It's also on my website. The second question about indigenous knowledge systems and decolonization. What I want to say is, it's always often caricatured. You want to take a step backward, you want to go back in the past, how will you do advanced science and technology? Therefore, I gave this example that you can do advanced science and technology, it is needed. And I'm saying that the difference is, you be critical. I'm not saying everything past was good. Of course, we made mistakes in the past. How can you say that there were no mistakes made in the past? So, you reject what is wrong and you accept what is right. So that's the distinction. You do work with indigenous knowledge, like I worked with Egyptian chord geometry or Indian chord geometry. This was unnecessarily rejected. Unnecessarily rejected as religious geometry. So that kind of polemic you want to throw aside. And you want to look at the content and you want to work with that content. So that's the idea, that you support indigenous knowledge systems, but critically. That's all.
Any other questions? We may have time for one more. If not, then it just remains me to thank you again, Professor Raju. I think if there's one message we all take away from this is that when you talk about decolonizing, whether it's math and science or any type of education, the first thing we need to decolonize is our minds. And that's the biggest challenge of all. Just on behalf of the university and the conference, I just want to thank you again. And we have a little gift for you to show our
appreciation. This is not a little gift, it's a big gift. Thank you.
Okay, and thank you all for your attendance. I appreciate it.